Hello, and welcome to the lecture for the TI Precision Lab discussing instrumentation amplifier parameters, specifically input bias current. In this video, we will cover two common application problems regarding input bias current. The first is how input bias current interacts with the high output impedance of a sensor connected to the IA input. The second is the importance of input bias current return paths for linear IA design. Just as described in a previous op-amp TIPL lecture, the input bias current, or IB, of an IA can be defined as the current flowing into or out of the inputs of the IA. These can be modeled as a current source connected to each input. Input offset current, or IOS, is defined as the mismatch between the input bias currents flowing into the two inputs. Typical values of input bias current at room temperature for bipolar input IAs ranges from 1 nanoamp to 50 nanoamps, and 1 picoamp to 50 picoamps for FET input IAs. Offset voltage, or VOS, is the differential input voltage that would have to be applied to force the IA's output to 0 volts. This can be modeled as a voltage source in series with the inverting input terminal of the IA. Typical offset voltages range from 2 millivolts down to tens of microvolts, depending on the IA. Understanding the effects of input bias current on the precision of an application is best done through an example. Let's take the following piezoelectric accelerometer example. This accelerometer consists of a mass attached to a piezoelectric crystal, which is mounted on a base and measures acceleration when subjected to vibration, and produces a voltage proportional to the acceleration. A vibration preamplifier converts the high impedance output of the accelerometer into a low impedance signal suitable for further processing. On this slide, you'll find a short list of common applications which use piezoelectric accelerometers. Here is a simplified schematic of a piezoelectric accelerometer preamp circuit to convert acceleration to a voltage potential. In this example, this accelerometer has a very high output impedance, or RO, of 1 megaohm. Let's see the effect of this high output impedance on our overall accuracy. Assume the IA we selected has an input bias current specification of 2.5 microamps. The effect of input bias current this IA has on the accelerometer results in a voltage drop, which creates an additional offset due to IB at the IA's inverting input equal to IB minus multiplied by RO, where IB minus is 2.5 microamps and RO is 1 megaohm. This offset due to IB simplifies to 2.5 volts. Keep in mind this offset does not include the intrinsic VOS of the IA. The VOS of the IA adds to this error, but we're focusing on the error due to IB specifically for now. This 2.5 volts of offset error due to IB at the input results in even more offset error at the output as we apply gain. As we have it drawn, this IA is configured in a gain of 100 volts per volt with plus minus 15 volt supplies. The output of this IA circuit would be driven to the rail, simply due to the IB offset error. The electrical potential of the accelerometer has been completely masked by the error of the circuit. This circuit does not work at all. You might be asking yourself, what if I balance the input of the IA by adding a 1 megaohm resistor from each input to ground in hopes of canceling these input bias current effects? Now the offset due to IB seen on the inverting input will be equal to the offset due to IB on the non-inverting input, and by the idealized model of an IA, the IA should amplify the differential voltage caused by the accelerometer and reject the common mode voltage caused by the output impedance and IB effects, right? Not quite. The input bias current of an IA is not equal on both inputs. Rather, they differ by what's defined as the input offset current, or IOS. Let's assume for this generic IA, the input offset current is equal to 30 nanoamps. To recap, IB minus is 2.5 microamps, IOS is 30 nanoamps, so IB plus is equal to 2.5 microamps plus 30 nanoamps, or 2.53 microamps. The offset we see due to IB on the non-inverting terminal is equal to 2.53 microamps multiplied by 1 mega ohm. This simplifies to 2.53 volts. Now we have an offset of 2.5 volts on the inverting input and 2.53 volts on the non-inverting input. Due to the idealized model of an IA, the IA's common mode rejection will only pass the differential voltage. In this case, the differential voltage is 30 millivolts. If we multiply the differential voltage by our gain of 100 volts per volt, this yields 3 volts of error at the output. This is better than the previous error, but still unacceptable in high precision applications. The easiest solution to this high output impedance IA processing issue would be to find an instrumentation amplifier which has low input bias current. As you may recall from earlier in this video, FET inputs IAs typically have lower input bias currents than bipolar input IAs. Texas Instruments has a wide portfolio of low input bias current IAs to explore for your next IA application. Although FET input IAs typically have lower IB than bipolar input IAs, Texas Instruments' new generation of bipolar input amplifiers are built on a precision complementary bipolar semiconductor technology that incorporates what's called super beta bipolar transistors. Let's see what this means. Let us first define the beta of a transistor. The beta of a transistor, or transistor current gain, is the ratio of the transistor's collector current, IC, to its base current, IB, as shown in this equation. The beta value is fixed for a given transistor and operating condition. This figure shows a simplified amplifier input stage using bipolar transistors. The value of beta for traditional bipolar transistors typically ranges from 50 to 200, which may lead to a sizable base current for a given collector current. For example, a transistor with a beta value of 100 and a collector current of 10 microamps will require 100 nanoamps of input bias current. In contrast, transistors with super beta technology have a much higher beta value, often well over 1000. Greatly reducing the IB needed for a given IC. Revisiting the example above, for a transistor with a beta value of 1000, the required input bias current is decreased to only 10 nanoamps. This is a 10x improvement over traditional bipolar transistors. To learn more about super beta input amplifiers, visit this application note. This slide covers the main benefits to TI's new super beta input amplifiers. As we have previously covered, low input bias current is crucial when interfacing with high source impedance sensors. In addition to this improved advantage of bipolar amplifiers, super beta input transistors offer lower input current noise. The current noise of an amplifier is important because it combines with the input impedance that results in additional offset voltage and error at the output. Super beta input amplifiers also preserve the same benefits as traditional CMOS and FET input amplifiers, such as low voltage noise and low 1 over F noise. This is suitable for high precision applications across all frequencies where filtering may be challenging, such as in medical instrumentation applications. This table here to the left compares the INA118 and IA with traditional bipolar transistors to the INA818. A precision IA with super beta transistors. Thanks to the super beta inputs of the INA818, the current noise is reduced by a factor of almost 20, and the IB is reduced by a factor of almost 10. Texas Instruments offers an extensive portfolio of precision super beta devices. I've highlighted a few here, but you may browse TI's IA portfolio by visiting ti.com/INAs. Let's revisit our piezoelectric accelerometer example from before. This time around, let's use the super beta input INA818. The INA818 has a typical input bias current specification of 0.15 nanoamps, owing to the super beta technology. The effective IB this IA has on the accelerometer results in a voltage drop, which creates an offset at the IA's input equal to IB minus multiplied by RO, where IB minus is now equal to 0.15 nanoamps and RO is still 1 megaohm. VOS due to IB simplifies to 0.15 millivolts. Multiplying this by our gain of 100 volts per volt, the IA output error due to IB is only 15 millivolts. This is much better than the previous results when the output was saturated against the rail. This result is also much better than the proposed solution of adding a resistor in hopes of canceling the IB effects. Another common application problem many engineers face when designing with an IA is neglecting an IB return path in both AC and DC applications. Let's see what this looks like. If there is no path to ground or other bias voltage for the input bias current, the circuit does not function properly. Let's take a look at an example of this. Assume the following IA has a 100 Hz sine wave with an amplitude of 100 millivolts in the presence of a 5-volt common mode voltage and a 3-volt DC voltage. Assume the desired output is a plus minus 1-volt signal. Using these operating conditions, the instrumentation amplifier must be configured with a gain of 10 volts per volt. Applying the same INA818, one of TI's high precision, low power, low noise IAs, the circuit schematic is shown here. This slide shows the transient analysis of our example scenario. While the 5-volt common mode voltage is rejected by the IA, the 3-volt DC voltage sums with the input differential voltage, shown by the VDIV curve here. In a gain of 10 volts per volt, the output signal was saturated against the positive power supply rail, even though the desired signal to amplify was the 100 millivolt 100 Hz sine wave. The 3-volt DC voltage prevented the instrumentation amplifier output from representing only the amplified AC signal. Eliminating the DC signal at the output due to the presence of a DC input voltage is important. Engineers often mistakenly configure an AC-coupled IA circuit by adding a capacitor in series with each input terminal, but without providing a path for the input bias current to flow. This mistake is illustrated here. If a capacitor is connected in series with an instrumentation amplifier input without a DC path for current to flow, then, over time, the IB of the IA charges the capacitor until the output is driven to one of the rails. A simple solution to this problem is to connect a resistor from each IA input to system ground or other bias voltage. This solution provides a path for the input bias current to properly bias the IA inputs. In a dual supply configuration, as shown in the top figure, each resistor is connected to ground. In a single supply configuration, in order to maximize the input voltage range, the input bias resistors are usually connected to a voltage, V bias, at mid-supply, as shown in the bottom schematic. This mid-supply connection serves a secondary purpose in that a typical IA input generally cannot swing all the way to the power supply rails. Thus, connecting the resistors to mid-supply maximizes the IA input dynamic range. Similarly, because the output of an IA cannot swing to the power supply rails, connecting a reference voltage, VREF, to mid-supply maximizes the output voltage dynamic swing. Be aware that both VREF and VBIAS must be able to sink and source current. Therefore, using a low dropout regulator, or LDO here, may be unacceptable because an LDO can only source current. A buffer or voltage reference is usually needed. Adding resistors and capacitors comes with its trade-offs, including increased noise, increased offset, and limited board space. Typical resistor values used for this purpose, seen as R1 and R2 here, range from 100 kiloohms to 1 megaohm. The values are usually chosen to be large compared to the differential source resistance. However, large resistor values introduce higher thermal noise and DC offset due to the IA input bias current flowing through the resistors and developing a voltage drop across the resistors. Additionally, the input bias current flows into the input impedances and produces voltages that add to the overall system error, as we discovered earlier in this video. In addition to the trade-offs of noise, offset error, and board space, these added components may affect overall precision. The resistors and capacitors added to the circuit in both input paths must be precisely matched to each other. That means R1 must match R2, and C1 must match C2. Any mismatch of these components degrades the AC common mode rejection ratio, or CMRR, which in turn converts this common mode signal into a differential signal and introduces error at the output of the circuit. In a future video covering IA parameters, we will discuss CMRR in further detail. One way, however, to preserve CMRR is by lowering the cutoff frequency of the RC combination. However, this method requires larger value resistors and capacitors, which again contributes to noise and board space. Another way of increasing precision is to add a third resistor that is typically 1/10 in value of the other two resistors. Let's see what this looks like. This third resistor would be connected differentially between the IA inputs. This figure shows the output error improvement by adding this third resistor. These circuits showcase the INA849, which has an input bias current of 50 nanoamps maximum. Remember, the input bias current flows into the input impedances to produce a voltage that then appears at the output of the instrumentation amplifier as error. If the IA is configured with gain, the error is also amplified, adding even more error at the output. Adding a third resistor between the inputs of the IA reduces the overall input impedance while preserving CMRR, which results in less system error at the output. In the left circuit, two perfectly matched 10 megaohm resistors are used. Adding the third 1 megaohm resistor reduces the output error significantly. Unfortunately, resistors cannot be perfectly matched in production. Instead, resistors are labeled according to their tolerance. A 1% 1 megaohm resistor can be up to 1% off and still be within tolerance. This slide shows two circuits where R1 and R2 varied 1% in opposite directions, the worst possible scenario. However, adding the third resistor significantly reduced the output error. Depending on the system requirements, this third resistor can allow a designer to use lower tolerance resistors and still achieve a high precision output. Be aware that this third resistor has a unique set of drawbacks. While adding the third resistor allows a designer to counteract the impact of large resistor mismatch between R1 and R2, adding this third resistor does reduce the overall impedance. Reducing the overall input impedance may affect the sensor circuit driving the IA. The designer must make sure that the impedance formed by R1 through R3 is still large compared to the source output impedance. Reducing the input impedance also changes the corner frequency of the DC blocking high-pass filter. Depending on the application, this corner frequency may need to be adjusted by increasing the size of the coupling capacitor. In the next few slides, we will discuss a few application examples. For a typical two-terminal electret microphone with the DC component to bias the internal JFET, an instrumentation amplifier can be used to amplify the differential voltage, as shown here. The microphone parameters determine the required biasing resistors. For a microphone with an output impedance of 2.2 kiloohms, do not use biasing resistors low enough to load the microphone and cause distortion, and large enough to induce excessive thermal noise. This trade-off must be evaluated and determined by the system requirements. After the biasing resistors are selected, the coupling capacitors can be calculated based on the frequency band required to pass. Another common application is temperature measurement with a thermocouple. A thermocouple is essentially a low impedance short that produces a small signal DC offset based on the Seebeck effect. This offset can be measured using an IA, as shown here. The thermocouple has a low output impedance, therefore two biasing resistors are not required. One biasing resistor can provide the necessary path to ground without creating a large offset error due to IB. To recap, the IB of an IA can be defined as the current flowing into or out of the inputs of the IA. Simple mistakes while building the circuit can result in large errors and unexpected outputs. Make sure to choose an IA with specs that don't hinder your application's precision requirements. Properly designing these circuits requires an understanding of the IA parameters as well as a circuit connected to the IA. That concludes this video covering input bias current effects and IA applications.